visible. Thank you. So we are very happy to be here today, and we really say thank you to all of you that join our webinar. This is our second webinar of the project Share4Carers, and the title of this webinar is Children of Parents with Mental Health Problems, Recommendation from European Young Carers and Good Practices for Prevention and Support. And in this title, there is the complexity and the importance of the theme of our project, that as a consortium, we are carrying on from 2019, right, guys? And today there are all our partners, and Fondazione di Liegro and the COMIP Association are the host of this webinar, but during these 2 years, of course, we work as a consortium with all our partners, Dynamizois, San Martin, the University of Gaziantep, and I can't remember all our partners, but I'm going to do this. Wait.
Dynamizois, I support you.
Okay.
You Fami.
And you Fami, of course. And so Share4Carers is a project that wants to share good practices for the psychoeducation of children of parents with mental health problems in Europe. And in order to draw attention of this topic and to exchange good practices, inform and raise awareness of mental health professional, citizen, people who live this condition, and to motivate family carers to seek support and care from mental health service. And also in order to developing proposal at both local and European level. And that's why we are very happy as Italian partner to say thanks to the ministry that has gained the interest and for this project, because during the last weeks we receive support from important organs and ministries of Italy. And at first, today's meeting enjoys the patronage of the Chamber of Deputies, and we are very happy for this, because this means it's a proof that this theme is very important and an important topic for Italian policy. And we had a letter of support from the Ministry of Disability. And we are very happy to say thank you today in present to the Ministry of Education that delegate a member of the staff, Professor Giovanni Romeo, that today is here with us. And we would like to start our webinar with a brief intervention from you. And so we give you the floor for a greeting for the start of our webinar.
Grazie.
We are going to translate the intervention of Professor.
Grazie mille, Anna Maria. Buon pomeriggio a tutti i partecipanti. Grazie per l'invito. Come detto, sono Gianni Romeo, lavoro al Ministero dell'Istruzione negli uffici di stretta collaborazione. Innanzitutto desidero porgere i saluti del Ministro, il Professor Patrizio Bianchi, e del Sottosegretario di Stato, l'Onorevole Rossano Sasso, con delega alla disabilità. I loro saluti e il loro rammarico per non essere presenti, purtroppo impegni governativi hanno richiesto la loro presenza in Parlamento. Oggi si parla di...
Vado a tradurre?
Ah, prego, scusami, com'è?
Professor Romeo say thanks to us, and he is very happy to join our webinar. And today he represents the Ministry of Education, Professor Bianchi, and the Undersecretary of the States, Rossano Sasso. And he works in the office of the Ministry of Education. And it's a very sensitive topic. It's a very sensitive topic for them because Undersecretary Sasso also has a delegation for disability.
Oggi voi parlate di ragazzi che hanno bisogno di una particolare cura, bisogno di cura che deriva dal particolare contesto familiare in cui vivono. Perché la scuola è importante? Perché la scuola non è soltanto il luogo dell'istruzione, ma anche e anche dopo la famiglia la principale agenzia di socializzazione, e l'impegno della scuola, riteniamo, debba moltiplicarsi nel caso in cui si vivono delle situazioni di disagio in famiglia.
Today we are going to speak of young people who need support because they live special needs inside their family, and the school as one of the main educational agency of our society can play a very key role in supporting young people.
Questi giovani hanno bisogno di particolare cura affinché con maggiore sicurezza, cioè come da etimo del termine sinecura, possano affrontare gli impegni che la vita di adulti presenterà a loro e che probabilmente ha già cominciato ad occuparli anche in tenera età. Immaginiamo anche quale situazione, come le situazioni di disagio si siano acuite durante la crisi pandemica sociale in un contesto familiare così complesso.
We suppose and we know that these young people need more care than the others because of their family condition, and they need more attention in order to allow them to play an active role in society, to become citizen of and actor of their life.
Voglio ricordare che il nostro Ministero ha impegnato anche risorse per il piano estate, risorse destinate al recupero delle competenze, al gap formativo, ma non bisogna pensare soltanto alle competenze disciplinari, ma anche alle competenze di relazione e di socializzazione. Attualmente stiamo avendo una risposta lusinghiera, forse anche superiore alle nostre aspettative, e ci auguriamo che anche questi ragazzi possano usufruire di queste possibilità.
So he would like to remind that Italian Ministry of Education allowed the use of a huge amount of reserves during the summer period to organize activity that could help young people not only to gain more knowledge about studies and competency, but also to enrich themselves with social and emotional competencies that are important as the other ones.
Ritorniamo alla cura, che penso sia un tema importante del vostro webinar. La cura dei cittadini, delle giovani generazioni in particolare, è un impegno istituzionale. La cura è anche un atto di amore, ma è importante che sia guidata dalla ragione, dall'esperienza. Per questo riteniamo di grande importanza questa iniziativa in cui si parlerà di buone pratiche da esercitarsi all'interfaccia tra le istituzioni e il mondo delle associazioni, che per noi rappresentano una fonte inesauribile di stimoli ancora più importanti perché dettati dalla pratica operativa.
So the take care of young people, of young citizens needs to be led by experience, and the association of the third sector and could play a key role with the institution to connect their experiences and practices.
Io chiudo ringraziandovi ancora per l'invito ed auspichiamo fortemente per il futuro una più forte interazione con la vostra associazione. Per noi è importante perché intendiamo caratterizzarci per la capacità anche di sapere ascoltare chi vive le problematiche proprio sul campo. Vi ringrazio ancora e rimango in ascolto dei lavori della conferenza.
He said many thanks to us, and he hope that in the future there will be the possibility to be connected with the association of the third sector, because together institution and third sector could be very good work. And he say thanks to us, and he will be with us to listen to our exchange of good practices and to the theme of the project. Many thanks, Professor. So I rapidly give the floor to Stefania Buoni, that is the president of COMIP Association. And today, Stefania, we will share with us the results of the survey that all the partners of Share4Carers Consortium did involving son and daughters of people with mental health problems. So thank you, Stefania.
Thank you. Just let me know if you see the slides moving or if you just see the first one.
No, they is moving.
Okay, then I will start. So thanks again to the Ministry of Education and to his staff. Today we are very happy to share with you the recommendations coming directly from European young carers and good practices for prevention and support. We created a questionnaire for daughters and sons who have parents with mental health problems, and we had a total number of respondents of 37 former young carers from many countries in Europe: Italy, Greece, Turkey, Belgium, France, Finland, and Germany. We explored five main areas. One is the context. We asked daughters and sons their situation when they were a child or an adolescent, the challenges they faced as a child and or adolescent, and the challenges they are facing now as adults or young adults. Then we asked about the young carers' needs, what young carers think would have helped them and what they would have needed. We also asked them to concentrate and look not only to the risks, but also the resilience. And so how to enhance positive characteristics and a positive outcome. And finally, we wanted to have young carers and former young carers say directly to policymakers, teachers, schools, civil society professionals and family members their own recommendations to help the children and adolescents of the future and change the world. We have had a wide span of respondents from 90 to 53 years old, because it's very difficult to have children talk about this issue directly now because of stigma, because of all the difficulties. So adults speak about when they were children and adolescents to help. We had a majority of female respondents, 31, and 6 male. We asked them which one of the parents has or has had mental health problems, and the majority said the mother. So 21, the mother, 13, the father, and 4, both parents. We also asked which diagnosis have their parents. And the majority answered bipolar disorder. Then we see schizophrenia There was also depression. I don't see it now in the graphic, but it's also depression and psychosis and schizoaffective disorder and personality disorder. What we wanted to know is who informed them about this. 16 out of the total number of respondents said they discovered by themselves. No one explained to them what the parents had. In other cases, we see the other parents stepping in. In other cases, the psychiatrist explaining to the child or to the adolescent, the grandma or grandpa or grandma, only three. One case, there's the sibling that explains to the sister or brother. Another question is, did your parents relapse and or stop taking their medications while they were still sick? And this data is quite shocking because 33 answered that the parents experience relapses and stopping the medication. So we need to work more on the awareness of the people with mental health problems. We have to break the taboo and make people learn how to care for their mental health and prevent relapses. We asked also if the children and adolescents lived with their parents with mental health problems, and the majority said yes, 31. Another question was if they have brothers or sisters, and many have, and so they often had to take care also of the younger siblings. The majority, as you can see, felt as they were caring not only for the sick parent, the mentally ill parent, but also for the siblings, the younger siblings. One question we asked, obviously respecting the privacy and anonymity, was if these former young carers, now as adults or young adults, suffer from a mental disorder, which doesn't mean it's the same on the parents, of course. And the majority said no, someone did not know, and someone said they have. And we also asked which diagnosis they received. And as many research already existing already says, the majority experience anxiety and depression due to the stressful situation. And one important question was also if they have ever embarked on psychotherapy for their own well-being. And the majority said yes. And so we see that there is quite a big awareness to and responsibility about their own well-being, and so doing something active to make them better. And now we go into the part that I love the most, since I have been a daughter myself as a child and adolescent. I wanted to give the floor, make them protagonists, those who have the lived experience. And these are some of the experiences that we received in the questionnaire from across Europe. Some says that the challenge was not knowing who to ask for help. Someone said the difficult part was putting aside my own emotion and experience because there was the urgency of the illness of the parent. The worst part, said someone else, was not knowing that my mom was having problems, so not having an explanation for the behaviors, and also having to keep the problem secret because of the taboo, and this brings isolation and loneliness. Having also to take care of the mom and the siblings while trying to survive myself, says someone, and also not being able to invite friends at home. There are many challenges that I have faced and some remain to this day, says another person interviewed. What she would have needed, what he or she would have needed, is to understand how to best act, but she didn't receive, he or she didn't receive adequate support and information. Also, what was missing was information about how to protect her or his own physical well-being. We see often in many answers that helplessness and loneliness comes very often. And also in some situation, the love for the parent doesn't always have a return because of the parent suffering. And also there's a huge challenge because these young carers have this dilemma. Should I stay and try and save my parent, or should I escape to save myself? And so sometimes it's hard to have hope for their future. Other experiences, these are all words we took from young daughters and sons. One said, the difficulty was going to school with a difficult situation at home. I was disheartened because I could not talk about it with the teachers, and which is why school is very important. Social life was linked to my mother, and I didn't have a real social life. So school definitely plays a key role. Some others said fear was the main challenge. Another said not having been able to fully cultivate all of my potential. One of the most serious challenges, said another, was that I had no right to express my needs. I was scared and under tension most of the time. Another says I felt wrong, inadequate, too sensitive and scared of everything. Another said difficulty trusting others. Another says, I definitely have a PTSD, stress syndrome, post-traumatic stress syndrome, that comes from the state of permanent anxiety during the first 20 years of my life. Another points out the academic difficulties, the delay in her studies or his studies, because the young carer had to and wanted to take care of the father, but also protect the mother. And also this went into also dysfunctional romantic relationships, but psychotherapy helped to recognize these patterns and working on them and live a better life. And now we go into something that we want to share with policymakers, but also professionals, school and other family members. These are all requests and recommendations from daughters and sons in Europe. Some says legal recognition of the condition of us young carers, children who often have to fight twice as much and on a bumpy road full of obstacles to get what we deserve. A professional safety net provided by default to the minor children of diagnosed persons. It is very important to implement a family psychologist like GPs and a psychologist at school who can act as lookouts who can pick up important signals. The school should be more open to the discussion of issues concerning mental disorders. In my opinion, there is still a lot of prejudice and even fear. Information and awareness campaigns that contribute to deconstructing the stigma on mental illness, which is more deeply rooted than others. Financial support and concrete help to allow us to study and also have the opportunity to take care of our mentally ill parents without having to risk losing precious years for our training due to family problems. Not only treat the psychiatric patient, but also push spouses and children towards professional awareness support with psychotherapy as needed. Always put children first and think about their physical and emotional safety. Another point that is very important and is linked to stigma regarding mental health is that this statement from one former young carer. The information at the moment is too genetically oriented, which increases the anxiety unnecessarily, in my opinion. It is not because we have a sick parent that we will necessarily be sick. It bothers me a lot that it is very often, too often, the first question I am asked when I say that my father is sick. Another point is, I wish I had realized sooner, it is not my job as a 10-year-old kid to have all the responsibility that I took and that was pushed on me. Peer support has had the biggest impact in my life, and I think that this is something that we should put resources to. Another one says, having someone who would have let me be me, letting me be a child, not be alone. against the world, I'm sure of everything. Sorry. I don't know if you still hear me. I have an issue with the internet. Just let me know if you now hear me again, and I will continue.
Do you hear me? Yes, Tania, we can hear you.
I go, yeah. Another
you have 2 minutes more.
Yeah, I'm quite finished. Another said, do not separate siblings and families in a brutal way, as was the case with my family. And another is saying that teachers gave her the attention that the parents failed to give her, showing interest in the world and the thoughts and stuff, and encouraging her to pursue the things that she was passionate about. Also, another one said that many of the adults around her or him saw and heard the cries of help, but refused to acknowledge them, as it's not easy to take the first step to intervene in this kind of family mess. No one wanted to take the responsibility. I will go to the conclusion. One thing that we would like to point out as former Daughters and Sons Young Carers, as an association, is that we can change things. We now see, we have seen the challenges, the difficulties, but there is hope, and the hope we are fighting for is that the first step we have to take as governments, as citizens, as people, as human beings, is to start opening ourselves to mental health for everyone. So this breaking the stigma is the very first step we have to take to make prevention. Because parents can be good parents, even when with the illness, if they are supported in time. And also by making sure that once a person is diagnosed, that they have the possibility to prevent the relapses. And also the schools play a huge role for all those children whose parents are not many parents are not diagnosed. They are not seen by psychiatrists. They are not in treatment. And those kids really have been our priority, because we have been in that position. So don't think only about the children of people who are followed by psychiatrists, but also those who are not diagnosed, because those are the ones that need more attention, especially in schools, and receive proper information about mental health. Thank you for listening, and we will share more in the coming weeks. Please share this webinar that we will upload on our YouTube channels to help us raise awareness and support young carers across the globe. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Stefania. Thank you for giving voice to our European sons and daughters of Share4Carers project. And now we would like to hear the voice of another daughter that today is going to share with us her experience and her work that he collected in a book, A Hidden Pain. And I would like to introduce Ms. Gaia Cusini from Italy. And she's vice president and co-founder of COMIP, as Stefania as well. And please, Gaia, if you want to say some few words about you and then introduce your book. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon to all. I'm here to talk about my work, my research work of my master thesis, that has just been published by COMIP and Cesvol Terni. Hidden Pain, Understanding as a Key to Supporting Children of Mentally Ill Parents and Their Family Context. We can start about where does this research come from. This research started from my personal experience combined with the skills acquired during my studies. For us children, it's very important to bring our past for an empowerment of our lives and those of our loved ones. And the heart of
Gaia, can I ask you to come closer to the to the microphone? Thank you.
The heart of this research has deep roots in this idea. I am one of those who is laborious carrying out their struggle with this experience. We want no one to be forced to fight so hard anymore. And,
You can see the slides moving.
Yes, now it's moving again. We are on a research approach now.
Yes. Of course, the research approach is a qualitative with naturalistic paradigm, chosen for the importance of qualitative method in building a knowledge that takes greater account of the complexity of human experience. The philosophy is a phenomenological philosophy acquired a deeper understanding of a phenomenon through a penetrating description of the way in which it is perceived by the subject who lives it. The method is a eidetic phenomenological method with the grounded theory elements, and the choice of this method is a result from the consideration regarding the system and can best go to seek fidelity to the phenomenon. The participants, in according to the qualitative research, the phenomenological method, the number of participants is generally contained. It can vary from 5 to 20 subjects. In this research, there is 10 grow-up children of people with mental illness from different parts of Italy. For the data collection, I prepare a semi-structured interview in four thematic notes. The four thematic notes are general description of the situation, the story of their own experience and action practices to manage the situation, the connected thoughts and emotion to the context, the needs to be able to live more serenely and better deal with the situation. For the data analysis process, I establish a coding in according to the method, divided into five categories: the critical elements, the negative effect on life of children, the emotional experience of children, the defense strategy implemented by children, and support elements. I try to explain a summary zoom to reflect on. A key point on which to focus attention is the general pervasiveness of this type of condition that affects every area of the life of the children. For this reason, the intervention, when they cannot be prevented, should be in the sense of alleviating at last partially the load that makes children perceive every aspect of their daily lives in burdensome and unsustainable way. As for the criticalities, it is to be taken more in consideration than due to limitation and dysfunction of mental health services. This that emerged highlighted the lack of empathy that can occur sometimes by professional dealing with the case and the scarcity of sufficient time for care and attention to the patients and his family imply a perception of a lack of adequate support by the services themselves. Children can find psychological problems that sometimes result in pathology because they live everyday life with the parents who are exposed to traumatic situation and risk. Is therefore a link in the development of symptoms and pathologies in children, not both because of genetics, but for the context in which they grow if they are exposed to reopening and continuous trauma. Children try to manage the situation with different strategies: awareness, search for autonomy, meaningful relationship, and search for physical detachment and especially emotional from the parent. Element that is very difficult to do and implement as the child feels responsible for the parent. Physical detachment is not simple, but if you can implement it, it generally helps at least in part children to better manage the relationship with the parent. An important supporting element that has emerged is the pause for children as acting element of change, thus contravening the ineluctability of the situation by becoming active agent for improvement concrete of their personal situation, but also that of those who live analogous situation. The will and the desire to give way to the pervasive suffering that invades them so to finding of meaning in trying to achieve a concrete and active change. To conclude, we can say that the importance of a close collaboration between services, professional working in the field of mental health and patients and families is without doubt essential and necessary to invest it in it, as well as on project of promotion and prevention of mental health in school settings, and on specific training addresses to professionals who work with children and young people so that they know how to relate to subjects from similar experiences.
Thank you very much, Gaia. Thank you for sharing your experience. That it's a very add value to our project to listen to the voice who experience this this condition, and it's really help for it's really helpful for us to bring this topic at local, national, and European level to really to gain the people who really as us at a different level, because we are the informal network who can do something, but it's really important that this voice arrive also at the institutional level, at the policy level. So really, really thanks. And I would like to remind to our guests and participants that if you want to answer something to our speakers, please use the chat and for asking our speaker the question that you would like to do and share. And now I would like to introduce the other moderator of the webinar, Jocelyn, our friend Jocelyn from the Center Neuropsychiatric of Saint Martin, who will help me to moderate the webinar today. Thank you, Jocelyn.
Thank you so much, Anna Maria. It's a great pleasure for me for joining us during this afternoon. I will give the floor to Dr. Lewis, and I believe it's a morning for you, Dr. Lewis, and it's a high pleasure to see you in this webinar this afternoon, because you are a high-level researcher. You conduct a lot of research in the United States, in Great Britain, and also in Europe, so I think you will deliver a very amazing speech about all the results of, or some of the results of your research. Thank you so much for joining us during this webinar, Dr. Lewis.
Thank you very much. It's an absolute pleasure to join you all in my morning and in your afternoon there in Europe. I will pull up my PowerPoint and share my screen. Okay, can I confirm that you all can see? Brilliant, that's great.
Yes, okay. It's perfect, thanks.
Perfect, wonderful. So as you mentioned, my name is Dr. Phelan Lewis. I'm with the University of Sussex, based in the UK, but currently based in the US. And I'll be sharing results and a bit of an overview of the MEWI project, supporting the mental health well-being of the European adolescent young carers. Let me use. Let's see if I can advance my slide. There we go. Okay. So the Horizon 2020 MEWI project actual title is Psychosocial Support for Promoting Mental Health and Well-being Among Adolescent Young Carers in Europe. It's aimed at strengthening the resilience of adolescent young carers, we shorten that to AYCs, to impact positively on their mental health and well-being. Our research project is based in 6 European countries: Italy, the Netherlands, Sweden, Switzerland, Slovenia, and the United Kingdom. And in our project, we defined adolescent young carers as young people between the ages of 15 to 17 years old who provide unpaid care, assistance, and support to a family member or friend who has a chronic illness, frailty, disability, addiction, or any other type of condition that might require ongoing care. Okay. So the MIRI project has been ongoing for quite a while now, for 42 months since January 2018, and we are finishing up the last bits and pieces of our work this summer. Our project had several work packages. The first was a cross-national online survey with over 10,000 respondents across our 6 EU countries, in which we identified over 2,000 adolescent young carers between the ages of 15 to 17 years old. And that survey was designed to create a profile of the needs, preferences for support of adolescent carers in Europe. We've also been engaged with policy and legal frameworks by conducting semi-structured interviews with policymakers and other workers in the legal sector. We've also conducted a systematic review of good practices across our 6 EU countries. There's a wide variety of awareness of young carers in our project countries, and so our systematic review does reflect that. We have also strived to center young carers in all of our work from the very beginning to its very end now through participatory co-design. And we call our work blended learning networks, in which we would have roundtable discussion with professionals and young carers. And also we had young carers sitting on our international advisory board as well to share their input and perspectives throughout the project. Ongoing through the project, we've also been focused on dissemination and knowledge translation, and we have a series of policy briefings and an online booklet, which has been designed with and by adolescent young carers. And you can find both the briefings and the online booklet at the website I've noted at the top of the slide there. And then finally, our project is really privileged to deliver a primary prevention intervention, and that'll be the focus of my presentation today. So we call our primary intervention the MIRI model. So the MIRI model consists of a psychosocial intervention and a mobile app for young carers. It is the first scientific intervention in the form of a clinical trial involving adolescent carers. And I think it can also probably say safely the first one during a national or global pandemic as well. Okay, so the MIRI intervention, it offers a program giving young carers the opportunity to have a language to talk about their feelings. It gives them tools in their toolbox to process their emotions and then engage in positive behaviors. The intervention is an adapted form of the DNAV model, which is developed by clinical psychologist Dr. Louise Hayes. And our MIRI intervention included 7 2-week-hour group meetings, one meeting per week held over a 7-week period. We utilized trained facilitators in our partner countries that might have been social workers, nurses, psychologists, but in the UK, with the country having such an advanced awareness of young carers and actual dedicated NGOs for young carers, the facilitators in our project were actually professionals who were already working with young carers. So that's the difference from our other 5 project countries. In terms of our research questions for their intervention, the primary research question we were concerned with is, does the MIRI intervention promote favorable changes in AYC's mental health and well-being outcomes compared to a control group? The second research question, and I will just going to move this so that I can read it. Let me go back here. I'm just going to move that over. There we go. That way I'm not blocking my screen. The secondary research question was, does the MIRI intervention lead to a greater improvement in educational or vocational outcomes than a control group? Our research design utilized a 2-armed parallel group cluster RCT in our 6 EU countries. And the evaluation design was a mixed methods evaluation design in which we used an online evaluation survey and also conducted focus groups and semi-structured individual interviews with the stakeholders involved in our project. And the evaluation was tested over three measurement points, the first at baseline, then 7 weeks later at the post-intervention, and then 3 months later at the post-intervention measurement point. We used a very large series of measurements in our online survey. I won't have time today to get into all of the details of those measurements, but just so that you are aware and have an overview, our instruments looked at psychological flexibility, mindfulness skills, resilience, hearing activities through the MACA, self-reported questions on work, training, education, and then of course the elephant in the room, the impact of COVID-19 onto their mental health, well-being, and also their experience of the intervention. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, should I start this slide over? Yes? Yes, okay. All right, I'm sorry about that. I didn't realize I had muted myself. So two different methods were planned for the delivery of the intervention. The first was a fully face-to-face approach in Italy, Slovenia, and the United Kingdom, and then a blended approach that combined face-to-face delivery, and then also utilizing our mobile app, which I'll get into a little bit later today. And that was adopted by Sweden, Switzerland, and the Netherlands. However, as we know, COVID-19 occurred last year, and so then we then had to move all of our interventions in all of our partner countries to an online method in which the weekly sessions were held via Zoom or Microsoft Teams. We had a total of 278 adolescent carers to participate in our intervention. And as you can see there on this slide, we had quite a varied participant count in our respective countries. And I will admit that recruitment was very difficult as we went through our series of waves of recruitment because of the COVID-19 pandemic. The most commonly reported health condition by the AYCs in terms of the family member that they care for was physical disabilities, followed by a mental health condition, and the next cognitive disorders like dementia or Alzheimer's. And for those AYCs who are caring for friends or another person not related to them, mental illness was the primary and most commonly reported health condition of the care recipient. The average age of the participants were around 16 years old. And then in all countries, the majority of the participants in either the intervention or control group identified as female. So I'll give really quickly now just an overview of our results. Do feel free to contact us for the very much more detailed outcomes of our randomized control trial. So we found that resilience scores at the post-intervention increased compared to the baseline, but then decreased again at the follow-up evaluation 3 months later. So this leads us to believe that longer-lasting interventions and also follow-up support efforts should really be coupled and together and needed to achieve long-term positive effects. All groups, whether intervention or control, increased their mindfulness skills from the baseline measurement to the follow-up measurement with a statistically significant mean time effect. And then also at follow-up, participants in the face-to-face intervention group more often reported that they were able to do their homework compared to the baseline, less often reported difficulties to perform well at school or training, and then also that they reported less worry about the person that they care for while at school, training, or work. As we had a qualitative element of our research project, I wanted to be sure to pull out one of the quotes that I felt really captures the spirit of our project. So this is from an AYC who participated in the intervention. "I have felt better about myself, and for the first time in a long time, I have felt that I am important." So I think better words could be spoken except out of the mouth of our AYCs in the project. So now moving on to the mobile app that we also use as part of our intervention. So the aim of the app was to deliver psychoeducational, psychotherapeutic, and social support for young carers at a distance, meaning online through their phone, and also provide educational resources and professional and peer support. It targets young carers and professionals. And the MeWe mobile app, like all of our work across the pack, across the project, was co-designed and developed together with young carers. And then finally, the mobile app was included as a core element of the country interventions in Sweden, Switzerland, and the Netherlands, respectively. So the app has the advantage of gathering information related to AYCs in one place, and it makes it possible for AYCs to interact with their peers and professionals. So, for example, they can send messages to each other in the chat box. They can comment on news that's posted in the app, and they can also contribute their own stories about what it's like to live as an adolescent young carer. The app also includes exercises that were used in the sessions in the MeWe project. So that might be mindfulness exercises, for example. And then we're also really pleased to say that it's a multilingual product available in several languages and hopefully more to come in the future. So this is a screen grab of the homepage of the mobile app in which you can see if there's news that we'd like to post, we can post it there on the homepage there. And we also have the chat function. So adolescent carers can talk to their peers, so their fellow adolescent young carers. And then also they can talk to professionals who might be moderating the app in their particular country. They also have the ability to utilize a diary function, so they can write their own reflections about maybe their mental health or their experience that day as a young carer. And then in a more public-facing forum, they can publish stories that they like in association to their caring role or their mental health in a more public forum there on the app as well. And finally, we're really pleased to say that the exercises from the MeWe DNAV model are also included there on the app. So at their discretion, at their own time, young carers are able to go back through the app and they can perhaps do a mindfulness exercise before going to bed or during a really stressful period in their life. Okay. In terms of our recommendations of the app, it was really found that online support was incredibly useful, particularly during the time of the pandemic when AYCs were no longer meeting face-to-face with either their project work or in school. And then also we recommend that online apps are more focused and certainly more involved in future work with young carers, mainly because of the benefit of person-centered support and counseling that can be offered through a mobile app. And then additionally, we say watch this space as the app will be available at no cost via Google Play and the App Store in EU and in the UK coming later this summer. So as I conclude, I'd like to give special thanks to all of the young carers who took part in our research over the 42 months of our project. We'd like to thank our funders, the European Union Horizon 2020 Research and Innovation Program. And then finally, my MeWe colleagues in absentia today who contributed to my PowerPoint today. And if you would like to get in touch and find out more about the app and perhaps maybe how it might be used in your own respective country, please do feel free to reach out to our research assistant, Miriam. And then if you have any overall questions about the MeWe project, particularly about some of our earlier work over the past few years, do feel free to get in touch with our principal investigator, Professor Elizabeth Hansen. And I've also included our project website at the bottom of your screen there. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lewis, for this inspiring speech. It's incredible. I'm very surprised because H 2020 projects are normally more theoretical. And of course, you collect a lot of data, but you reach also a goal with the application. And it's very useful and it's an incredible result. Congratulations for this fabulous result. And the link is very easy with the next speaker. She is Khadija Marsh, Maybe I misspell your surname. Sorry for this. You are a psychologist. You work in France, and you are the co-founder of GEFSI. It's a very interesting initiative with Belgium, Switzerland, Luxembourg, and France. And I'm very glad to hear about this new website and your organization. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. And thank you very much for inviting me to introduce you to our new website. I'm going to share the screen. Yes. Okay. So I am Khadija Mash from the Funambule Falleret, and I'm going to introduce you to our new project, the website in French for children and siblings of people with mental illness. The nonprofit organization Œuvre Falleret has a long history of protecting vulnerable people. It was founded a long time ago in 1841, and in 2000 it became a nonprofit organization that manages structures and services dedicated to people suffering from mental illness. Nowadays, part of its mission is to support family carers. It offers services and innovative schemes such as the séjour de répit, and more recently, the Funambule Falleret facility. It supports children, teenagers, and young adults affected by the mental suffering of a family member. The Funambule Falleret has recently developed the GEFSI platform dedicated to young people facing the mental illness of a family member. You may wonder why we developed this website. It is necessary to remind that the organization of psychiatric care has evolved considerably. This had a strong impact on young people affected by the mental illness of a family member. Psychiatry has undergone a major transformation under the impact of the deinstitutionalization movement, which has taken place in two distinct phases. The first, around 1970s, was based on a clearly therapeutical goal. The aim was to encourage the discharge of patients from psychiatric institutions. And the second is the time of the development of ambulatory care that we are currently experiencing. It is mainly based on an economic goal of cost reduction. As a matter of fact, the burden of families has increased, and families have had to face directly with the illness of their relatives. It is in this context that the notion of the family carer has appeared in psychiatry. It was a real change in the way we historically represented the role of families. While they were once considered as the cause of their relative health problem, families are now seen as the solution. Today, 60 to 70% of people with psychiatric disorders live with their family. This transformation in the organization of care has a significant impact on children. So children live at the patient's home. They are called the forgotten children. And as Professor Thierry Bobet rightly says, there are children who are forgotten and children who forget themselves. There are forgotten children who alternate between a trivialization of their situation, since they are ignored by the health system that takes care of their parents or sibling, and a dramatization of their situation when they are seen as children at risk who are under the care of child protection, or as children at higher risk of developing a mental illness in their turn. There are also children who forget themselves because they are isolated and suffer from loneliness. They do not talk about it because of family loyalty. They have internalized the stigma of mental illness that make it taboo. And they do not trust institutions and professionals they meet. Before introducing you to our brand new website and services, let me tell you about how all this started. It began at one of the premieres of a wonderful film, which is Into Dad's Wood by Vero Krasitborn. It was around the promotion of this film that our four professional teams met. our France team, Funambule Falray, and the Belgian team of Étincelle at first, and then the Swiss team, Biceps, and the Luxembourg team, Canel, join us. This movie deals with the emergence of a father's mental illness through the eyes of his 15-year-old daughter, Gina. This film is a good way to talk about these issues with young people. Thus, we decided to build the educational file that will help educators and teachers to talk about the mental illness of a loved one and its repercussion on young people. Our four teams shared the same observation. These young people are invisible in the organization of care in adult psychiatry. These young people do not realize what they are experiencing, so they don't ask for help. And once they are adults, they say how much they lack support. We arrived at a shared observation, which is the difficulty of reaching this young audience. So we pool our resources for a double challenge. Our aim is to reach the young people concerned, but we must be careful not to reinforce their stigmatization. Indeed, as we have said, these young people are not used to ask for help, even if they are in need. So we had to think about how to start a conversation. We want to develop specific preventive support. We want to innovate in mediation and information tools. And this need has become more urgent because of the health crisis. Indeed, many children and teenagers have been confined with a sick relative without support or adapted information. Our issues and values. We advocate a phenomenological approach. This means that we start from the daily experience of young people, their questions, their experience knowledge. Our prevention message is the following. The situation you are experiencing is not unusual. Other young people are experiencing similar things. Feeling strange, confused, or scared in this situation does not mean that you are ill yourself. Their perception must be recognized and validated. The platform that we created has three main goals: preventing risk, so preventing the repercussion of disorders on children, promoting respect for children's right to support their resilience, supporting young people in an innovative and personalized way. Our goals and means. So now let's go directly to the website. So it's up to date and colorful. All visitors entering will see Jeff, our mascot, who goes along with the young person throughout his visit. Jeff is the acronym of Jeune Enfant Fratrie, young child sibling. The turtle on his back is a sign of the vulnerabilities and fragilities that we all carry to a greater or lesser extent, whether we are ill or not. The platform is structured around different sections. The first section offers a better understanding of the illness, understanding the effect that the illness has on me, and understanding what the illness does to my relative. There is also a glossary to help young people find their way around and understand the word they hear and do not always understand. The second section, being help, aims to enable people, young people, to find real help through a chat with a professional, a phone to talk by email to our team, a phone appointment with a professional. And these three channels can obviously lead to an appointment with one of our four services. The third section, exchange, respond to a shared desire to allow young people to discuss in a group with other young people who are experiencing a similar situation, whatever the country. People have to register to access to the group. Conversation have predefined topics and are moderated by one or two professionals from our four services. And a media library is also available on our site. Our four departments form a reliable and permanent team. We are all engaged in this project and in one-to-one relation, introducing ourselves with our real names. This site is the result of a collective work. It has been co-created at each stage of its development. and it has enabled us to pull our tools and expertise. So the GFC platform is now operating, and I invite you to visit it and to talk about it around you. If you have any question, I'll be happy to answer. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Khadija. It was so interesting, and it's a really funny website. I think the design is very great, very funny, very enjoyable, and it's quite important. And
I just want to add that the design was made by a young person who is concerned by the situation as well.
Great. It's nice to involve the users in the construction, in the co-construction of the website. But it's more than a website, it's like a platform. And I think we can make the link with the MeWe project and with the mobile app, maybe, of Dr. Lewis, maybe there is some link to do. So I have to give the floor to the next and the last speaker. It's Elena Kulikowska, and she's involved, of course, in many government and many advocacy action, but now she works for All Time. It's a charity organization, if I understand well. So I give you the floor. Thank you so much, Elena.
Thank you. If I could be allowed to share my screen, please. I've got some slides to show.
Yes, of course. Please do.
Yes, you know, you can share. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you.
Maybe you can try with the full screen.
Hopefully everyone can see this now.
Yes, it's perfect.
You know, we pay our taxes. We go through our daily life thinking that we live in a civilized society, and yet people like you.
Apologies. My video is playing too early. Right, let me try that again. Here we go. Okay, so yes, hello everyone. My name is Helena Kulikowska, and I am a development director of Our Time Charity. So who are we? We are a charity based in the United Kingdom, and we are the only charity in the United Kingdom that specifically supports children whose parents have a mental illness. We were officially established in 2012, but our projects have been running for over 20 years now. In the UK, we fall behind other more developed countries in terms of sort of a national strategy and support for children of parents with a mental illness. I know that Australia and some of the Scandinavian countries have specific legislation in place for this group. Sadly, that is not the case in the UK. So our charity exists to give, similarly to Stefania's organisation in Italy, we exist to give these young children and young people a voice and campaign for them to be recognised nationally and for support and funding to be allocated to them. So we have developed specialist interventions here in the UK, some of which have been disseminated internationally in Germany, Spain, and Iceland. And these interventions are aimed at children of parents who have a mental illness, and they're aimed at increasing their resilience and reducing their risk of developing mental health problems in later life. So a very quick overview of our programmes. We have developed two specific interventions for children of parents with a mental illness. The first we call the Kids Time Workshops, and that's a whole family, multi-family intervention for families where one or more parents has a mental illness. So these are well established here in the UK. The majority of our workshops are take place in London, but we do have projects in other parts of the United Kingdom. And we have lots of these projects in Germany and Spain, and we're just about to launch one in Iceland too, which is very exciting. So these are peer-to-peer community workshops for families where one or more parent has a mental illness. They meet once a month after school in a community setting. They are delivered by a local team of professionals and practitioners who are trained by our charity. Any agency that works with families and children can refer into a Kids Time workshop, and families can refer themselves as well. Whilst one Kids Time workshop can sort of work with anywhere between 10 to 20 families at any one time, that is quite a small, well, a very small splash in the ocean when you think how many children and young people are living with a parent with a mental illness. However, all of the children are at school. So for that reason, we set up a training and awareness raising program for schools and colleges. So that's training teachers to understand the issue, identify children in the classroom that might be affected, and support them in the right way without targeting them or making them feel like, you know, they are the problem or that there is something wrong with them. And we have developed a whole awareness raising program and teaching materials for pupils as well. So we've got a whole kind of school curriculum around mental health and mental illness, which we roll out in schools here in the UK. So our approach, our Kids Time workshops and our schools program are based on three key protective factors proven to build resilience in children where a parent has a mental illness. These are having a good explanation. So it's really important for the children and young people to be supported to make sense of their parents' illness. Having an explanation makes mental illness less frightening, and also helps to dispel some of the myths and misconceptions that exist around mental illness. For example, a lot of the young people worry that they will develop a mental illness because their parent has one as well, or they feel responsible for their parent's illness. Secondly, it's knowing you're not alone. By creating, bringing families together who live in the same community with a shared experience, it helps to tackle the isolation and stigma that many of them face. Many of them feel that it, their family is really unusual. There's nobody else like them. So actually connecting them and helping them to build social networks and relationships with other people in the same situation, we've been told is incredibly empowering. And finally, it's giving them access to a neutral, trusted adult to talk to. So somebody who is outside of the family and can help the child to develop a more objective view of their situation and support them to ask for help if they need it and act as their advocate. Previous evaluations of our work have shown that our interventions increase understanding of mental illness in both parents and children, help to improve parent and child relationships, reduce feelings of fear, shame, and isolation, and also boost confidence. So a kids' time workshop, what is it? So the structure is the same absolutely every time. And each session, which takes place once a month, will explore a topic to do with mental health and mental illness. That might be really explicit. So it might be, what is mental health and what is mental illness and what's the difference? Or it might be more subtle. So we might take a topic like coming out of lockdown, but explore or experiences of lockdown and explore that from the perspective of families where a parent has a mental illness. Everybody comes together in the same place. There's always a time for kind of settling down. We welcome families with snacks and refreshments. And then we move in to the first part of the workshop, which is adults and children together. That's where we introduce our theme or topic. There is always games and activities that the families do together to get them thinking about that topic and discussing it as a family and also collectively with the other families in the room. At the heart of the workshop, the parents and the children split off for an hour. The parents have a sort of confidential talking time, which is not therapy. It's a peer-to-peer conversation, which is facilitated by one of the workshop practitioners. And that's where they can share some of their experiences and challenges of parenting with a mental illness. Without sort of fear or judgment. And the facilitator is there to make sure the focus stays on the children. So getting the parents to think about, you know, what their children might make of their illness and how could they support their children. Whilst that's happening, the children will work with a drama practitioner for an hour, and we always use drama as a really powerful and effective tool for the children to engage with their thoughts, feelings and experiences, but without feeling vulnerable or exposed. So instead of saying this is my experience, they will take the topic of the workshop and they'll create a story and use characters to kind of engage with that topic. But of course, many of the children will have experienced some of the themes themselves in their real lives. Everybody comes back together. There's always pizza. That's a great way of encouraging families to come. And we all sit together and watch the drama that has been, the children's drama that has been filmed. And that's a really, really important part of the workshop because it's a light bulb moment for many parents who think, my goodness, I had no idea how much my child knew about my illness or how much they worried. And the purpose of that is not to make them feel bad or guilty, because many parents already do worry, you know, have I damaged my children or what impact has my illness had on my children? So it's not there to make the parents feel guilty. It's to help open up the conversation about mental illness within the family, because sometimes it hasn't even been spoken about inside of the family, and coming to the workshop might be the first time the family are actually openly talking about it. So it sparks the conversation, it brings mental illness out of the darkness, out into the open, something that is acceptable to be talked about, and the family can start kind of together with the other families and with the support of the facilitators, start to develop some of their own kind of coping strategies and building resilience. In terms of the influences, just some important things to note. We take a psychoeducational approach, so it's educating about mental illness, but it's not therapy. So whilst we draw on therapeutic approaches, it is not a therapeutic or a treatment intervention. We very much take influence from systemic and whole family working, but kids' time is very much a voluntary, active community. So there is no hierarchy. So it is a very kind of open and welcoming space where the participants, parents and children, are encouraged to be active participants in their own care, as opposed to passive recipients of education or information. really big emphasis on stress reduction and drama and giving the young people and the parents a voice. We think a lot about the language that is used and different cultural perspectives and interpretations of mental illness and some of the complexities around that, and get the family thinking about what's a helpful way of thinking and talking about it. And whilst the whole family benefits, the focus is always on the children. And then our schools program follows very similar principles, but it is obviously aimed at both teachers and pupils. And whilst the purpose of it is to support children who have a parent with a mental illness, it's actually a universal program. So our approach is to educate the whole school and the whole classroom, so everybody is aware about mental health and mental illness. And that enables a more compassionate and less punitive and stigmatizing culture to flourish in schools. And the outcome of that is that pupils who might be affected feel then safe to come forward and speak to their teacher and say, oh, you know, I think I know somebody in this situation, or this is my situation. And the teacher then feels confident and equipped to be able to have a supportive conversation with the child. I'm going to finish with a short video, because what better way to demonstrate our work than in the words of our beneficiaries. So if you bear with me one moment, I will get that up for you now.
You know, we pay our taxes, we go through our daily life thinking that we live in a civilized society, and yet people like you, children like you, can actually get left behind, can get forgotten about, which is why a charity like this is so important. How did it come into your life, and what role did it play?
So my mum developed bipolar disorder when I was born, and as a result, you know, she faced a lot of adversities, I didn't get to find out about kids' time until around about when I was age 15, and it was a social worker who turned up at home, told us about Kids Time, the Kids Time workshop.
Yeah.
And what you mentioned is really crucial, because these young people are not the troublemakers. They are the ones who want to hide away. They are the ones silent and quiet. They're withdrawn. You know, they don't want to share their feelings and the situations with other young people or professionals, because they worry that, you know, their families could get broken up. They're worried about being bullied. They worry that they could be stigmatized by society. So they hide away, they shy away. So it takes really a trained eye and a passionate and compassionate eye to spot these young people and bring them in and include them. And, you know, when they come into the Kids Time space, you know, like Connie said, I echo that. It's something that I've experienced. And now, you know, supporting other children, I see.
Because you've become a trustee of the charity, of course.
Yes, I have. And these kids, they come in there and they just, you know, just explore everything. They take part.
Well, talk to me more about you rather than them. Tell me about the first time you went. Presumably, you're a little bit in your shell to start with, and you begin to sort of think, hang on a minute.
Yes.
For the first time in my life, I'm in a room where everybody gets it.
Yes. So the first experience for me was very peculiar, because as a young child, I was very quiet. I was very shy. So coming in there, the first day, I didn't take part, but it didn't take long for me to take part. I felt like I was amongst family, you know, people that really get it, you know, people that pay attention to you and make you feel special, people that want you to share your feelings and, you know, what's going on in your life without stigmatizing you. I felt the compassion, I felt the love, I felt, you know, I was really free to share. And there, within that space, I found my voice. I found, you know, and I felt, you know, this is something I'm experiencing. This is something that a lot of people are experiencing. They're probably not sharing what they're going on because of the fear of being stigmatized. But I thought, let me model this to them. Let me talk more about it to give them that power that they need to share more about the experiences that they're facing.
And how did it change you outside the charity, outside the workshops? What did you take back into your normal life?
So at that time in the workshop, the founder, Dr. Alan Cooklin, there was a social worker, there was a dramatist there. And I really admire these people around me. Mm. You know, these were kind people, and this was something that I wanted to do. I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do in my career at that time, but I looked to them and I just thought, I want to give back, I want to be like them. So I decided to go into the mental health field, and I love it. You know, now I help mothers who struggle, who have mental health difficulties themselves. I help other young people who also struggle with maybe their own mental health problems, or sort of caring for a parent with a mental health problem.
So what happened to the shyness?
It's gone.
Okay, thank you very much. And if you'd like to find out more about our Kids Time Workshop interventions, please feel free to contact me. I shall put my email address in the chat. So we work with many partner organisations. We have a licence for our interventions and can offer training and consultancy in setting up Kids Time Workshops wherever you are. So thank you for listening.
Many thanks, Elena. It's so interesting, and we have a lot to learn about your everyday work. Thank you for sharing with us your experience. Unfortunately, time flies and we don't have time for questions, but you have the direct email from each speaker. And so please don't hesitate to contact and to share with the speaker, because I think it's quite really important to share at international level the good practices, the good experience, and all we have to say about this really important issue. So before giving the floor to Anna Maria for the closing remarks, I would like to once again thank all the speakers. It was really a high-level webinar. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being with us. And take care. The floor is yours, Anna Maria.
Thank you. Thank you, Jocelyn. Stefani and I, as Italian host, would like to thank you very much for join us today with this second webinar of Share4Carers project. Your presence today was priceless for the project, your experience. And today, I think we have another confirm that people that are expert by experience can give an invaluable add to the process on the discourse of mental health, and with the professionals, with the researcher, and it's a very choreutical discourse, the one on mental health. So I would like to thank you very much to all of you, to the representative that of Italian Ministry of Education that today join us, Gianni Romeo, and all our speakers. And so Stefania. Ah, I would like also to remind you one important appointment in Greece that the Pioni reminds to us, the 23 and 24, there will be the meeting and the webinar version of the meeting of young carers in Greece, and with the support of the Office of the European Parliament. So save the date. And Stefania.
From me and also from Gaia, we want to say thank you for being here with us, but most of all, take these seeds of hope, take them away with you, share them with as many as people as possible. And don't be afraid to write to the institution, because I didn't have any acquaintances. I just sent them a letter and somebody finally replied. So they were participating today. So even if you're small, 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 like a mosquito, you can make a big difference for many people, and not only children, also their parents. So we can make this world kinder and braver, and yeah, change the world like we wanted as the children. Thank you to everyone.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you so very much to Stefania and your team. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Thanks so much. Bye. Bye.
Thank you all. Thank you all.
Dear partners, can you hear me? Evgenia is talking.
Yes, we hear you.
Can the partners stay in, for a few moments in order to say a few words together, and then we will leave the meeting just for a few moments, if you can.
Okay, so we say hello to our guests, and as a consortium of Share4Carers project, we will stay for a few minutes. Thank you. Bye to our guests.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Hello.
Hello.
I guess we are all together now.
Yeah. It was so interesting, really interesting. I really enjoyed the speakers. It's so wonderful, and all the project. And I think we have the link. I don't know how, but we have to make the link with the H2020 project and the Jeff C platform. Because I think it's quite complementary.
And we can include. We could include. We could.